हेलो डियर स्टूडेंट्स, माई सेल्फ आरती शर्मा, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर इन कंप्यूटर साइंस डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ आर्य कॉलेज ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग एंड आईटी। टुडे इन दिस लेक्चर वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट सपोर्ट वेक्टर मशीन व्हिच इज पार्ट ऑफ यूनिट फोर्थ लर्निंग ऑफ आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू कवर इंट्रोडक्शन अबाउट सपोर्ट वेक्टर मशीन, हाइपर प्लेन एंड सपोर्ट वेक्टर, idea of working behind the support vector machine, kernel tricks used in support vector machine, advantages and disadvantages, and application areas of SVM. So let's start with the introduction section. The very first thing is where the machine support vector machine fits in the machine learning. Why we are talking about machine learning? As we know, machine learning is a subset of AI. So here we are using this algorithm. As we know, machine learning has three type of learning methods: supervised learning, unsupervised learning, and reinforcement learning. In supervised learning, we use the trained data set to train the machine, and in unsupervised learning, where we guess or predict the sense of the data without using a trained data set. In the reinforcement learning, we reinforces the algorithm to check the good or bad behavior of input and predict the data output. So basically, support vector machine fits in the supervised learning method. Here we know the support in supervised learning machine views the past input data set and make further predictions as output. In supervised learning, we have two things: classification and regression. And here the support vector machine uses these both of the methods to classify the data. So we can say that in the support vector machine, we basically identify the two data sets separate the two data sets. That if suppose we have two data images, one is of a strawberry and second is of apple, it help us to differentiate the apple and strawberry images as a two different classes. It divide the data set in two different classes, or it is using the binary formation or you can say it as a sample of positive data set and negative data set that will be separated with a hyperplane and classify the data in two data classes. The SVM is a supervised learning algorithm, and supervised learning model help us to predict the correct output out of it. As we already know that it will use a pre data set. So we teach the machine through the algorithm, feed the data in it about the images of various fruits like strawberry. And then when we use this trained model, it will help us to get the image as correctly identifying it as a strawberry. So yes, it will able to predict the image correctly out of it. This is the technique. This technique will be used by the support vector machine to identify the two different classes of apple and strawberry in our example. So it will be this idea will work. This is the way why we are using the support vector machine here. So next is what is support vector machine. As we know, we have already discussed that it is a supervised learning algorithm, and it is capable for performing the classification, regression, and even the outlier detections. Before going to cover the SVM, first, you should have a pre-knowledge of linear regression and logistic regression, so that you can understand the support vector machine process in a better way. So that this the regression topic is already discussed in the previous lecture. It is used for both the regression task and the classification task, but it is widely used in the classification algorithms. It is applicable for the data that are linearly separable and also used for the kernel functions. Most of the experts use it to produce the significant accuracy with less computation power, and it is highly preferred by the experts to train the model to get the outputs. So the next topic is, what is a support vector machine? It is the objective to find a hyperplane in a n dimensional space. N means we have n number of features, and basically we are talking about two features, so it can be called as a binary classification, as we are using x1 and x2 as a number of features, two features that distinctly classify the data points. So here we have two sort of features, x1 and x2. One is red labeled and second is black labeled circles, and these are the possible hyperplanes we can create in our data set to predict the data. And this is the way how we used to maximize the hyperplane and maximize the margin to between the two different classes of data. And this blue line will be called as optimal hyperplane, and it acts as a classifier between the two different classes of X1 data type and X2 data type. It helps us to separate the two classes of data points, and there are many hyperplanes, and out of those we can choose the one with the maximum margin by using this algorithm. It helps us to identify the maximum distance between the data points of both the classes. It maximizes the marginal distance. This is the marginal distance between x1 and x2. It produces some reinforcement so that further the data points can be classified with more confidence, and can classify the data sets in the two different classes. So the very first thing we should know, that what is hyperplanes and what is the support vectors. So with the help of the figure, we can able to know that there are two sort of hyperplanes used to feature for feature space. That is two-dimensional hyperplane and three-dimensional space, or you can say it as 2D feature space or 3D feature space. This is a diagram for 2D feature space. Here called as R2, and it is represented with a line, and this line will help us to separate the two sort of data points or two classes of data in a two-dimensional space. And this is the hyperplane called R3, and this plane is a 3D feature space. Here we are defining the data in a 3D feature space, and this is created how if it is randomly we have a large cluster of data and we split in the air and create a plate difference, or by we can create a separation between the two data sets by using a disk or a plate, and it will help us to identify the two different data sets. This is the plane which is distinguishing the two different data classes of red labeled and black labeled data sets. The hyperplanes are dimensional boundaries that help to classify the data points, as we have already seen in the figure that this is the decision boundary of the hyperplane, and it classifies the two different data points The data points falling on either of the side of the hyperplane are the attributes to the different classes. The dimension of the point of hyperplane depend upon the number of features. Like in the first figure, we have two features, so it is a two-dimensional feature space and it is represented with a 2D figure. And in the second example, we have three features, so it will be denoted with the help of a 3D figure or a 3D feature space or a plane. So if we have large number of features, it will be called a multi-dimensional feature space. If the number of inputs feature is 2, then the hyperplane is just a single line and it will be represented with 2D space. If the number of inputs is 3 or more than 3, then if 3 it will be, then the hyperplane is a two-dimensional plane and it is difficult to margin when the number of features exceed 3. So then it will be called as a multi-dimensional space. So here the support vector, what the support vector is, with the help of this figure we can identify the support vector. Suppose this is the hyperplane where the two data points are separated with the hyperplane. The points or the data which are existing on these two margins of positive line or the negative line exist. These are called the support vectors, which create some smallest margin or the largest margin between the two different data classes. These are called the support vectors. So this will and this will be the support vector here, and this one is the support vector here. This is the largest margin between the two data classes and help us to identify the maximum margin and the smallest margin between the two data classes. The support vectors are the data points closer to the hyperplane and influence the position and orientation of a hyperplane. And by using the support vectors, we can maximize the margin by using the classifier. Detection of the support vectors will change the position of the hyperplane, and they are the points useful to build a SVM, as it will help us to decide the type of the hyperplane we are going to follow to find the output results. So SVM classifies the two classes using the hyperplane. This hyperplane should have the largest margin with the highest high dimensional space given with the data into the classes. The margin between the two classes represent the largest distance between closest data point of the classes. The data point should be as close as possible to the hyperplane. So you can say it as in this figure, we see that these two points are the nearest to this hyperplane, and here these are the two points which are nearest to the hyperplane. This will help us to generate the margin between the two data sets, and it will help us to calculate the marginal distance between the two classes. So now the next topic comes that how this SVM works. So the main idea behind the SVM is, the very first thing is, first we imagine that we will use a vector W which is perpendicular to this hyperplane and to the medium, to this medium line, which is the hyperplane acting as a classifier. In this figure, we have classified the two data sets of negative data and the positive data. These are the two vector spaces which are nearest to this hyperplane. So the main idea of working of this SVM is depend on, suppose this would be called as a W vector, and this is perpendicular to the medium of the line of the hyperplane. This W vector is the weight vector in the real world sample which is provided to us in the question. and let's suppose u vector will be any vector which is taken as a input vector. So when projected on the w vector, if it crosses the plus sample boundary, then it is classified as plus, else it is classified as a minus vector. It means if we are getting an input as a input vector which is supposed to be u vector, and when it is projected according to the w vector, if it comes under the plus vector space, it will be classified as plus data class, or either it will be classified as minus data class. So according to our example, the output is nothing but the category of data. It helps us to predict the category of u vector or the input vector. What the support vector mentioned here is that we project the u vector on w vector. If it is lies with the category of w vector, which is perpendicular vector, belongs to which class? So w vector is the number of features or the preferences given to the data points to predict the category of document, and whether the u vector belong to the, suppose here we have two features, that either the data will be of sports document or a political document, then the u vector will generate, we get the output that whether the u vector will belong to sports document or a political document. And w vector is assigned to each term vector and help to identify the category of the data. It means when we get an input vector, and suppose the minus will be the sports vector and plus will be the political vector. So when we impose u vector on w vector, the w vector category will help us to assign that vector to u and help to identify the category of u vector input data, to which class it belongs, either to the sports vector or the political vector, political document. In the other way, this is the whole theoretical aspect, how it is working. And in mathematical sense, we use these two mathematical inductions to classify the two classes, that u vector is dot product with w vector plus with b is greater than equals to 1. This is belongs to the plus class. And this formulation will belong to the minus class. Suppose the input sample belongs to sports category, and suppose if the sample belongs to sports category, and then it will belong to the plus class. And if the input sample will belong to the political document category, it will belong to the minus class. Here the b is a constant distance between the two vectors which lies nearest to the hyperplane. As we can see, these are the two support vectors. This is the b will be the constant distance between these two points. Y of I is the output, and suppose it is a plus for the plus sample, and when it gets minus 1, it belongs to the minus sampled data category. So suppose we use this formulation, y of I with this formula, w of w vector with dot product of u vector plus p and minus 1 is greater than equal to 0. This will be the formulation is used to calculate the category of the data. So for the sample data lying on the margin or the support vector is called to be as a, this formula is equals to 0. So how to find the width of the margin? The width of the margin will be calculated with this form of equation or formula, and that is x plus minus x minus of x minus x, and x is the feature, and this is the data point. These are the support vectors of plus data and the minus sample data, and this will be the formula. This will be the called as multiplied with W vector divided with the magnitude of the weight vector. Here the plus and minus is the support vector, and this is called the magnitude of the vector, weight vector, and this W of vector is the weight vector. So we can say that in according to our equation, in this formula, when you are getting y of I as plus 1 for x plus data class or support vector, and y I is the minus 1 for the x of minus support vector or minus data class, so we can substitute the value as x plus is equals to 1 minus b, or x of minus is equals to 1 plus b. So the width will be calculated as 2 by magnitude of weight vector. The width need to be maximized according to the SVM. So we get the maximized value by it means our formula should give the maximum width. So this value should be maximum to be found while calculation. Our goal is to maximize the hyperplane or maximize this value, so which is equivalent to minimum of this magnitude of weight. It means when you are getting this result, it means the weight magnitude of weight vector should be minimum, which is equivalent to half of this magnitude square. So the weight vector should be this one. So finally, we can say that weight vector of optimal value, so such that the margin is separated to more between the two classes is found. Also, the distance between the support vector of the two different classes, and the margin is chosen to be small. So we finish the training phase of the SVM, and we get our optimal hyperplane in the output, and can classify the input vector to which class it belongs, either to the sports category or the political category, either to the minus sample data or to the plus sample data. So this will be generating the linear linear hyperplane. And when we are talking about the non-linear decision boundary, we will going to use kernel trick in SVM. So suppose we are having this sort of data inputs as a 2D hyperplane. Here these blue dots will be one class and the black dots will be another class. And this cannot be separated with a single line. So this can be transformed with the help of a kernel trick in a 3D hyperplane. The SVM can handle a non-linear separable data by using these kernel functions to a 2D plane by adding one more hyperplane to separate the two different classes. Some of the type of kernel functions we can use are linear, RBF or a Gaussian kernel, or a radial basis function. This RBF is called the radial basis function or the Gaussian kernel. The Gaussian kernel is nothing but this is actually the theoretically it will transform the data into an infinite dimensional space for classification. It usually recommended to try to classify using the RBF kernel because it generates the good results. And the next is polynomial, and the last is either it will be using a sigmoid function. as we are using sigmoid function in the kernel tricks, so it will give us the result in a logistic format or the logistic graphical formations. The kernel functions are mathematical functions which are the mapping functions which, when used and map the input data, so add the dimensions to the input data in such a way that it will separate the two different classes in a hyperplane. So the output will be look like this. And here the output graph is in a logistic regression format or a S-shaped graph. So when I use this kernel function, it will generate a S-shaped graph. So so out of these all these discussions, we have come to know the next is advantages of support vector machine. The SVM works well when there is a clear margin between separation between the two classes. It is more effective in a high dimensional spaces. It is effectively work in the case when the number of dimensions is greater than the number of samples, and it is relatively less using less memory. The kernel trick is a main strength of SVM as we are applying kernel functions to solve the more complex problems. As we are using logistic regression, it will help us to generate the results of complex problems easily. And next is the disadvantage of a support vector machine. It is not easy to apply the kernel functions as these are complex. It need a large knowledge before going to apply it. We should take a large training time for train the large data set before going to use it, as it is a supervised learning technique. We need a large training data set before going to use it well. SVM will use a hyper parameters like gamma. It is not an easy way to use the hyper parameters. It is hard to visualize the data on the graph. So it is difficult to visualize the data. Next is the support vector classifier works by putting the data points above and below the classifier planes. So it is not there is no probabilistic explanations for the classification. Next is it is difficult to understand and interpret the final model weights and individual impacts without having a pre-knowledge of the support vector algorithms and the training machines. So it must be done with a well knowledge. Before going to implement it, you should have a pre-knowledge of all the functionalities before going to implement it. But there are various application areas where we use the SVM. Nowadays, in most of the ANN application areas, these are used. We are using it as a in handwriting recognition, face detection, text and hypertext classifications, bioinformatics, classifying the images, and almost in all the areas of the ANN, it is used to identify the data and classify the data sets or in help to find the output results. I think this lecture will help you to understand about support vector machine and its advantage, disadvantage, working applications and application areas. So I think this lecture will be beneficial to you. Thank you.